So just some introductory things. Those of you who were here last time, it's going to be old news to you, but the format of this webinar is not on presentations. It's around the breakouts where we get an opportunity to share together, talk with one another around the material in the book. So it's not some talking head sharing information that we may or may not already know, and not leaving us opportunity to really engage with one another. This is for you, for small church pastors and leaders. It's sharing ideas from the reading and encouraging one another in the work that God has given us to do. There will be two more of these, February 8th and February 22nd, to finish out the discussion of the book. We'll do this brief time at the beginning as the introduction. I've got a few things I want to share with you. Then we'll move into the breakouts. And so that'll be about 40 minutes worth of time to just share together and talk about the things that you discovered in the book and how that's resonated with you, new insights that maybe have come to you. And sharing of the insights and applications will come at the end. We'll spend about 20 minutes at the end just sharing together some of the things that came out of our time and our sharing together. So just to remind you, the Zoom will not record the breakouts. It'll only record this and then our time at the end sharing insights and applications. This section in Karl's book moves to a bit more of a hopeful scenario from here's the situation with small churches to now how can we begin thinking differently about the churches that we are leading and serving. He says, what if there is a way, this comes from chapter one, but what if there is a way for small churches to be dynamic and healthy? For some, that may be an oxymoron, I don't know. But that's really what this section is about. And in this section, he makes a couple of comments. One is a question. He says, if the differences between small churches and big churches are not about one being better than the other, what are they about? And that's a really good question, because I know that sometimes I am predisposed to thinking that small churches are the best thing since sliced bread. And so I have a prejudice, if you will, against big churches. Full transparency, okay? But that's not the point of this. It's not a matter of whether one's better than the other, but it's really about what are the differences? And the differences that he says are found in the methods that we use to accomplish the mission that God has given us all. That's really the difference between the two. So he's encouraging us to move beyond an us versus them mentality, and I appreciate that, and thoroughly embrace our place in the larger body, to think differently about the place that God has given us to serve and how that can impact the kingdom of God. So we're going to spend some time talking about that in each of the chapters with the questions. I hope everyone has the questions from the study guide to interact with. And if you don't, chat me real quick, and I will try to send you a copy, a PDF, as soon as I can. So anybody not have the questions? All good? Oh, Hector, you do not? Okay. All right.
Oh, sorry. I'm a latecomer.
That's okay. So we're going to move into the breakout rooms. And while we're doing that, Hector, can you chat me your email address, please? And just put it in the chat box, and I will get that out to you while we're breaking out into our breakouts, okay? Well, welcome back all to being together here for a few minutes and share around some of the things that popped out for you, insights, results of the conversations, and maybe a takeaway or two that you feel will be good for you as you move forward in what the Lord has given you to do there. So any particular insights that really just popped out at you as you guys were talking through these particular chapters and this theme in the book?
Just remembering to live out the Great Commission, just a very good reminder.
Well, our group leader didn't get us through the whole lesson. For the second week in a row, I got through about half. So, but I didn't even get to the point of asking someone to summarize for us. So we're, Kevin, maybe you could help us out there. You're a good listener. You're gonna have to unmute your mic.
Well, I know that we had a good discussion about seeing that talking about the numbers, and I personally, I really like that the quote, Jesus didn't wake up this morning depressed about our size of our church, and how that is helpful for us to be reminded of that. For me personally, I struggle with that all the time. And I need to be reminded often of that, that it's not based on the numbers, my success or my part in the kingdom of God and my value to the Lord is not based on numbers. We talked about the importance of relationship, and I loved what Bill had to say, talking about some things he's doing, but relationship as mission. And how important that is to value the relationships. As a small church, we can do that. Mm-hmm. It's a bit easier for us to do that. And I'm thinking about our own church and how important it is for us to gather together for these meals that bigger churches have more difficulty doing, but we can do it. And it's such a rich time for us. I don't know, anything else?
Bill? That was good.
Also for the same group, the comment that I wrote down, I really like, is that we find ourselves concerned about sustainability, but that isn't really our problem. That's God's problem.
Mm.
I needed to hear that.
Wow. Okay. That's great. Anybody else resonate with that? Good.
You know, Roy, I think that's a great comment. I just reminded of that lesson being driven home to me just as COVID was starting. And one of my deacons that is probably the most quiet man I've ever met in my life, he hardly ever says anything, but when he does speak, it's always profound. And just as COVID was starting and we were discussing, the governor was going to shut down services for a certain period of time and, people weren't going to come. And as a small church, you're always kind of right there on the edge of, all right, if the offerings don't come in, then the bills don't get paid and neither does the pastor. It gets to be a dicey issue. And so we were brainstorming about what are we going to do and how do we handle this? And after a while, that one deacon stopped and he said, this church is 225 years old. It's been through wars and depressions and political upheaval. He said, the Lord's never abandoned us yet. I don't think he's going to do it now. And the minute he said that, the whole conversation changed. My own included, all the elders and deacons just went, you're right. And the amazing thing from then on, we're one of those really weird churches that offerings increased during COVID. Mm-hmm. And God just showed how great he is. So to echo what Lori mentioned, we're so concerned about sustainability. It's not our church, it's his. And so that's his worry, not mine. And I really love that. Thank you for sharing that.
It's great. So I'm not afraid of silence, and I will refuse to fill it up with, things that are going around in my head. you guys need to, if you got something that popped out of you, or even anything that changed in your thinking, you know, as you went through this.
I was reflecting on how in a smaller church, the reality that churches have a lifespan just like people do is more at the forefront. And that's both good and bad. It's good. It's bad in the sense that, you know, you can have the same kinds of anxieties that you do that we were just talking about based on where you perceive the trajectory of the of your church to be. But I think living in the moment of the joy of a church life event or living in the sadness together is much more, because it's relational, it's much more evident in a smaller church than it is in a larger church where you're programming for nobody in particular. These are particular people who are meeting together and having, we just lost a dear member of our presbytery who's a retired pastor, but a very important part of our congregation. And we're all grieving that together. It's not a good time, but it's a time of, it's a time of reflection in a church that you don't get in a larger church. And I think that's a healthy thing. And it's a good thing to recognize together that we're at this point in the life of this church. And we have to deal with the grief together because we're one body and we're all feeling that. And same thing with times of joy, times of growth, times of contraction, all those things. Times of, are we going to get through COVID together? You know, those things are more pointed and real in a smaller church than they are in a larger church, I think. And I'm grateful for that. I think that's a healthy thing for a church.
See a lot of heads nodding.
Plus, if I can say this, I think that Lori Lasure is cute, and I'm going to see what she's doing after the meeting. She's not only wise, but she's cute.
Okay, guys.
She's my wife and not my sister, by the way.
I know. So we chatted a little bit, and one of the questions I thought I would bring up at the end, Ian actually brought it up. Responding to the mantra that Vaters had, that they are always striving to increase their capacity for effective ministry. How did you respond to that? It may not have come up in your group, but in your reading.
I was going to say, my group didn't quite get to that question.
Yeah, it's okay.
Can you ask that again, Roy? I'm sorry, I didn't quite get it.
So Vaters says that in his church, the mantra that they have is, we are always striving to increase our capacity for effective ministry.
Would you give the page number? Because sometimes I write my notes right next to the quote.
Yeah, it's
94.
Yeah, 94, right.
Okay.
Thank you, Bill. I think my reaction to that question is I didn't like it. I didn't like it one bit. Because it's such a pertinent question, right? I mean, if we're not asking that question, man, but that's a challenging question, isn't it? I know in my personal, you know, journey into this relationship as missions worldview has required a kind of shift in almost personality for me. I'm a gregarious, outgoing person, but I like to do my gregarious, outgoing things at other people's houses. You know, and so to open up my house every week on a Sunday night for a Bible study dinner, that was something I believe I need to be doing in this period. It's where the world is, but it's not my nature, you know, and so that's expanding capacity. That's what he's getting at is I remember asking myself about 3 years ago, the things I need to do, I'm not sure I want to do them. And I think as a pastor, but as any kind of church or layperson, that's a tough place to be, but I think it's the place we're all going to have to get if we're going to find a version of sustainability in this day and age.
All right. On that page, I had my little markings. I had a big question mark next to the quote. Next to the question mark, I wrote down, I underlined his statement. I wrote down, I don't know if I understand exactly what it means by that. And I put, why not use healthy church, striving to be a healthy church as what you're striving towards. And then you need to define what means to be a healthy church, which I guess he did, you know, back on page 86, ingredients for a healthy church. You love and worship Jesus. You love, serve, and make disciples of others. And I've said in the past, I would look at a healthy church, when you look at your membership, the healthier each member can, the healthier, in other words, the discipleship in their own life, the healthier the members get, the healthier the church becomes. Mm-hmm. And to break it down that small, and so the healthier, the higher percentage of healthy members, the higher is the healthier the church as a whole gets. You know, as they learn to love and worship Jesus more and more in their life, as they learn to love and serve others and are part of some discipling process, the more people you get doing those things, the healthier the church is. The effective capacity for effective ministry, my guess is, and somebody could tell me what he means, maybe you know, my guess is the more people involved in ministry, the more people you have involved in ministry, effective ministry, your church has greater capacity for ministry as the more people involved in ministry. I don't know. Anyway, that's why I had a big question mark. I was like, I don't know if I really understand what you say. And why not just say we strive to be a healthy church? Because I really like the emphasis of the book overall of it's not about are you growing? It's about being striving to be healthy, understanding what makes a church healthy and how can we get healthier. And whether you grow or not, that's a side part, you know. But are we healthy? And what does it mean to be healthy and how can we be healthier?
I like that, Matt. I think that's a good pushback. I really do.
It made me think about Tom Rainer's Simple Church book and a quote in Tom Rainer's Simple Church book about what he called alignment. So this is, you know, sort of once you said this is who we are or you know who you are and this is what we're called to do, then you need to start bringing all of your ministries into alignment. And what it reminded me of is Rainer saying, and during this process of alignment is when pastors get fired. So it's this idea that you're going to have to shut down things that are not producing fruit, right? You're going to have to prune and trim. And in the small church context, you know, the at least in my experience, the notion that, but that's the way we've always done it is strong here. And so in my short tenure here, I haven't been here quite 3 years, that idea of saying, well, you know, we don't have to do it that way anymore. And we could instead invest in these other things. It's a slow process, but that's what it made me think of.
I also think that it's part of both what Matt was saying and Bill was saying. If your individuals are growing in faith, they're going to want to do something, hopefully. Although I will say that I'll push back a little bit on Matt, say some people do not necessarily include action in health. They ought to, but they don't always. And Bill, you're talking about alignment. And so part of the church's increased capacity for mission involves something that's beyond what I might be doing in mission and involves us in mission.
And there's a lot of power in what you just said. And I want to say that I guess my concern, you know, there's a uniqueness to, you know, the context where I am, it's the first church I've served that at one point was much larger and now is smaller. And that's a different dynamic than the small churches I've served before, which were always small. And it's this idea that we have to keep all of these things that we did when we were much larger going. And so the alignment part of this, the move toward health, is to say, you're all exhausted. You know, I've entered into a season this year, actually the last year, well, 2022 and moving in 2023, where I've said, we're not doing anything new. Until we stop doing some of the things that we're doing, there's no capacity here to do anything new, right? And so you need to, and frankly, you know, it made me think of Leviticus, because I talk about Leviticus all the time. It's kind of my specialty. But it's that Sabbath of Sabbaths, right? And God says to Israel that, look, if you don't do these Sabbaths, then there's going to come a time when the land is going to lay fallow, right? Because of exile, let's be clear. And you're going to make up for every Sabbath year that you skipped. And I'm trying to tell the church, it's like you've been burning the, you know, candle at both ends for so long that there's nothing left to burn. So we're going to have to stop and recover. And so that's kind of where we're at right now.
So going back into this a little bit, prior to the pandemic, I was doing some surveys. I surveyed all the members of both churches, and then I was meeting with each member to go over their survey. And what I realized I had accidentally created was a discipleship tool, not a survey. And in education, they have what's called an individualized lesson plan. Usually your child gets one if they're a problem, air quotes around problem, right? They're different. But this is part of this, me having to think hard about changing my capacity for ministry. But I hear the health thing Matt said really is had a kind of jarred loose some things in my brain for me. You know, we're really trying to disciple members of our church. As pastors, have we, and elders, whatever our role is, leaders, have we any metric for how we're actually doing this? Have we bothered to create any measurement for this thing that we say we're about doing? And I have to look in the mirror and say, no, I haven't. I'm just going on my intuition. And at some level, you know, it's not a lot of trouble for me to track 60 people. It really isn't. Teachers do it all the time. And so, you know, that's where I say it's been a season of evaluation. I think, you know, maybe sliding that word health in there instead of capacity makes a lot of sense for maybe for us who are in the smaller church. You got to remember, Vader's idea of small is under 300. For most of us, we're under 100. And so it's very different. But anyway, I'm going on too long, Roy. Sorry, I'll stop now. It's but okay. That really did, I'm going to be getting off of here and writing some notes and thinking about some things. So
that's really, and I'm glad you mentioned that, Bill, because that's really what we hope in this, is that this will be a catalyst for you. Your situation, each of your situations is unique. There are commonalities among all of them, but you know, if this can be a catalyst for some new thoughts, some better approaches, and obviously our aim is health. That's our aim ultimately, that the church is healthy. Because if it's healthy, the way I define effective is that it accomplishes the purpose for which it was designed. That's effectiveness. Okay. And if the church, we know what the purpose of the church is, then that's what we want to be effective about. And it all circles around how healthy can we be in that process. So, all right. So very quickly, I'm going to open it up. Last question. One takeaway, one thing that you feel like, okay, like Bill said, I can chew on that. You know, that's going to be something I'm going to work with and play with and see what the Lord wants to do in my thinking. Anybody willing to share one thing you're going to take away from this?
You know, I like a lot of you, whenever you go to a conference, the question that people like to ask each other and the pastors is, you know, the size of your church. How big is your church? And I wrote down a note during this time of the better question that we could all ask that everybody should like to talk about is, tell me something healthy about your church.
Great question.
It doesn't matter what size it is, everybody can tell something healthy about their church. And how much more affirming and uplifting, and instead of being reminded of, oh, well, you know, what's your membership, you know? Tell me something healthy about your church. And wouldn't that be fun just to talk to people and have them tell you something healthy about their church? That'd be fun.
I wonder if we could answer that question.
But if every small church pastor made that the question they asked every pastor they met at General Assembly, how would that change the culture of the EPC?
Great point. Good question. Thanks, Matt. Anything else?
For me, the first time I read through this, which was right after General Assembly when you gave us the book, the need to change the culture of a church, to measure or change the culture of the church, which is not something that we talk about much as pastors, but it comes from my organizational change management background in business, led me to go read that book that he references, Dirt Matters. So if any of you are running into culture issues, go get that book. That's a good book. Mm-hmm.
As has often been said, culture eats strategy for breakfast.
And unfortunately, culture has eaten a few young pastors as well.
Absolutely.
Amen.
All right. Anything else? All right, then. Thank you for being a part of this. I hope it has been helpful and encouraging for you. We will meet again on February the 8th. Please feel free to share it. If you have ruling elders that are able to join in, we can make sure they get beyond the ruling elders we have. We can get them the study guide questions and the like. They're welcome to join in on this. But if not, then may the Lord grant you all much grace and make your work fruitful for the kingdom. You are doing good work and the Lord sees you. Never forget that. The Lord sees you. Okay. All right. Thank you. We'll see you next time, February the 8th.